those of you that have joined us live stream, thank you for being here with us. I want us to turn to our text today. It's 1 Chronicles 14. 1 Chronicles 14, and we're going to be talking about a place of breakthrough. A place of breakthrough. Everybody comes to a point in life where they need a breakthrough. Sometimes what is happening in our life doesn't even look like that's what's about to happen. It doesn't look like that it's going to lead to a breakthrough. It looks bad before it looks broke through. And I've got to tell somebody this morning, don't pay attention to what it looks like. Don't look at what it appears to be. And you'll understand a little bit more when we get into the message today. In 1 Chronicles 14, verse 8, "And when the Philistines heard that David was anointed king over all Israel, all the Philistines went up to seek him." Listen to that. It looked like a wonderful thing was happening, and all of a sudden, something really bad happened. All the enemies in the Philistine camp come up against David. And David heard of it and went out against them. And the Philistines came and spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. And David inquired of God, saying, "Shall I go up against the Philistines, and wilt thou deliver them into mine hand?" And the Lord said unto him, "Go up, for I will deliver them into thine hand." And they came up to Baal-perazim, and David smote them there. Then David said, "God hath broken in upon mine enemies by mine hand like the breaking forth of waters." Somebody shout breakthrough. I'm claiming for my breakthrough. I need God to give me a breakthrough. Therefore, they called the name of that place Baal-perazim. He is the God of breakthrough this morning. Amen. Let's make our confession together. I will believe God's word. I will be who it says I can be. I will do what he says I can do. To God be the glory forever and forever. And everybody shouted amen. Somebody shout breakthrough. Breakthrough. I got to tell somebody, breakthrough is coming. I want us to look at this morning. And because of the season that it is, last week this country stopped and paused on Monday on Memorial Day to pay tribute to our sons and daughters, our grandpas and grandmas who fought in the wars and died and shed their blood and sacrificed their lives so that we could be free and we could be doing what we are doing right here. You got to understand that the road to our liberty that we're enjoying today, young people, was stained with their blood. I had a peepaw that was in the Navy, and I would ask peepaw, share some of those stories, and he would get so emotional that he would just cry. He couldn't even tell me. It was so horrible, and it was so awful what he saw on that Navy vessel. My dad was in the Air Force, and there was only one story that he would share with us, and there's a story when he got saved. He was a gunner on a bomber, and they were going on a bombing mission, and he was saying, "Lord," he made a lot of deals with God under those circumstances, but this one stuck because it didn't look like they were going to make it back. That's the only one he would share with me. He couldn't share a lot of things that he saw, but he did share the night he got saved. His mom and dad were Pentecostal preachers, and they started tent revivals everywhere and started several churches. And I pray tribute to them because they prayed for my dad to come out of that situation. And that night he gave his heart to the Lord and became a preacher and passed the mantle down to four boys that he raised. And we're all in the ministry today. He could not talk about the horrors that they saw. It's a horrible thing because the road that leads to the liberty that you and I enjoy today is stained with these soldiers, with these people who fought and died for this liberty. And I thank God for the sacrifice that they made. Brother Ricky spoke of law enforcement. I think I saw his picture on TV, and my heart broke. And I thought about that road that these men also, they laid their lives down, and they make the supreme sacrifice because they're out there trying to keep us safe. But I want to talk about another road. It's called the road of suffering, the Via Dolorosa. It's the one that Jesus went up when he carried the cross, and he stained that path with his blood all the way up to Calvary's hill. And he died there, and he laid down his life, and he sacrificed his blood for us. So what does that have to do with anything? I want you to understand, though Jesus paid the price for my victory, I still have to fight because the devil always comes back. And that's what these scriptures are about. The Lord dealt with me this week. Tell the people, look and see what I've said in my word. No matter how many victories, no matter how many battles you fought, the devil always comes back. World War II was called the war to end all wars. But guess what? After World War II, and so many died in that war and blood was shed, we thank God for those people who fought, those people who died in World War II. But to their disappointment, World War I, there was a World War II. You know why? Because the enemy, he comes back. He comes back. Look at your neighbor and say, get ready, because sometimes the devil, he comes back. World War II happened. And today is actually the anniversary, the 77th anniversary of Operation Overlord. And you may know it as D-Day, because that's what I know it as, D-Day. D-Day. Today's the anniversary of D-Day. There's approximately about 4,000 World War II veterans alive in the U.S. today. And in leading up to today, the anniversary of D-Day, they interviewed one of the survivors, and they asked him, what do you think about the progress that has been made since you fought on the beaches, I believe, of Normandy on D-Day, and you survived? He saw many of his friends and brothers in arms and sisters perish, but he lived. And he says, you can tell the story. What would you say? He says, I'm very disappointed at the progress. I don't really want to die while I'm seeing the world in the shape that it is in. You know why? Because no matter how much blood is shed, the devil, he still comes back. The enemy, he may rise up in another form, and you've got to be vigilant. Jesus put in the heart of Pastor Peter to write, you've got to be sober and vigilant always. Why? Because you got an adversary, the devil, who walketh about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. And so the Bible says we got to learn to war a good warfare, because the fight ain't over yet. I don't know how many victories God has given us in our life. And I don't know how many sacrifices have been made. Jesus went to the cross, and he bled and died on Calvary to purchase my anointing, my salvation, and my deliverance. But that don't mean, Brother Ricky, that I'm not a soldier in the army of the Lord, that I don't have to fight. Because there's going to be a first fight, a second fight, a third fight, a fourth fight. He keeps coming back. And we have to put on the whole armor of God. You never retire out of God's armor. Me. There's always a fight that we must engage in. And we've got to understand that this story, the battles in the Bible, tells us that these are great, great victorious people with great, great anointing that understood that their last battle that they just celebrated, and so many of the people that they lost in that battle, is not really their last battle. But there's going to be another one, and we've got to stay vigilant because the devil wants to keep us with our guard down so that he can attack us and he can ambush us. And there's so many people being ambushed today. Things just come out of nowhere. I want you to look at the text. The Bible says when the Philistines heard that David was anointed king over all of Israel, all the Philistines went up to seek him. Now, you got to understand, this was David's third anointing. Everybody shout, three times the charm. Three times the charm. Isn't that our old saying? Third time's the charm. Well, it didn't look like much of a charm. First time was Prophet Samuel. He goes in and he says, Jesse, you got any more children? Oh, yeah, that's right. See, all the people that he put before him were in the military, and they weren't the ones that God chose. He was looking for a man after God's own heart, and it was David. David was somewhere. He said, I got another one. He said, well, go get him, and that was the one. And he poured the horn of oil on David's head. And that was his first anointing. And the Bible said the Holy Spirit came upon him from that day forward. The second anointing, you think, man, he got anointed. Yeah, not long after that, he had to face Goliath. And you think, well, I thought it was supposed to, everything was supposed to go right. And there wouldn't be any more problems after you got the anointing of the Holy Ghost. No. You don't understand what the anointing's for. The anointing is for you to be able to go up against giants. And to stand and to come out victorious for the glory of God. Well, he won that battle. And then it seemed like everything started coming apart. And his own countrymen turned against him. Became jealous of him. His anointing wasn't so popular with them. It became a threat. And because of his anointing, they couldn't stand him. They despised him. And the Bible tells us that he had to run for his life. And his own kindred in the tribe of Judah saw that God's favor was upon him, and they discerned that he needed to be their leader. So they broke off from backslidden Saul, and they anointed David king over Judah. And that was his second anointing. Things get better? Not really. He still had to fight. He still had trouble. He still had problems. He still had to be vigilant. He still had to trust God because things weren't over. You think, man, he's got a double portion. He's got a double anointing. I want you to know, bigger levels, higher levels, bigger devils. I've always heard that. So when God speaks an extra portion of blessing and anointing upon you, you need to become really alert and vigilant because God is not just giving you that power and anointing and position for you to go on vacation and say, oh, I got it made now. Oh, no. The devil's coming back. He's going to test that anointing. He's going to see what God sees in you is for real. He's going to test what God has spoken over your life. He don't take God's word for it. He said, I'm going to challenge that. I'm going to stand up to that. God says this. The devil says, we're going to come and see about that. And so I just got to tell somebody that your battles that have come upon you is probably because God has anointed you. And that you've got to understand that he's given you that empowerment to overcome the things that has attacked your life and has come against your life. The third anointing. Man, you got to be kidding me. Three anointings? I didn't know there was such a thing as three anointings. David received three anointings, and he had been through so many things. And now it looked like, the Bible says that it looked like in that same chapter that God had confirmed his kingdom. and that everything was coming together. And some of the people that was his greatest enemies were now gathered around him saying, we want you to lead us. We want to anoint you leader over us. The people that actually were trying to form an attack against his life and had become his enemies were now wanting him anointed over them to lead them. And it looked so great. And he said, man, what more can you ask for? I got everything now. Everything's got to be all right now. Everything, you know, my battle, my war days to struggle and fight for these anointings and for my promotion in the kingdom of God and for all the things that I've always wanted to see God do that he spoke over my life, it has come to pass. Well, praise the Lord. Let's have a picnic and a celebration. That's not exactly what happened. I hate to burst your bubble, but I want you to know when God raises you to another level of anointing and promotion, it's just going to bring bigger devils into your life that you got to learn to fight and overcome. And so the Bible says when all of Israel came and they all placed their anointing upon him, the devil said, that's okay. All of us are going to come and we're going to get to. See, this was not just one giant. This wasn't just a portion of an army. The Bible says when they all came together and poured all their anointing on him, all their approval and promotion on him, when he had gotten all of them to come together and bless him with another third level anointing and promotion. And the word of God over his life was fulfilled. The Bible said all the Philistines heard what God had done in his life. Let me tell you, when God speaks something, and I know there's not going to be a whole lot of shouting and amen in this morning when you're talking about when God gives you anointing, the devil's just going to turn up the burner. Everybody, you know, that's not a happy occasion. But I just want to, I'm not out here trying to make things appear to be something that they're not for people of God, and then when they step out there and the devil comes with everything he's got at this place in their life, and then they say, well, I did not know that this was the way it was going to be. I'm just here to tell you, honey, yes, that's exactly the way sometimes things turn out. And when you look at David's life, God showed me in his life that with this greater anointing came a more horrific battle. Nothing causes the enemy to gather his forces more than God pouring his anointing on your life. And when you get to a certain place in life, he says they're ready to be elevated and they're ready to be raised up. They're ready for another place, a higher level, and I'm going to take to, and I'm going to give them more of where that came from. A lot of people, you know, they got the baptism of the Holy Ghost 30 years ago, and they think today they still got the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And I found out that in Acts chapter 2, they were baptized with the Holy Ghost. In Acts chapter 4, they assembled after the enemy had threatened them and arrested their leaders and let them go and beat them up. They gathered in a prayer room, and what happened? The place was shaken where they were gathered, and they were all filled again with the Holy Ghost. Let me tell you something. When the Holy Ghost does something wonderful in your life and empowers you, he knows what's down the road. He knows you're going to need it. And you need another filling after the devil brings everything against you. You need to understand that you need to continually be refilled with God's power and anointing. I heard George Moxley this week, and I'd never heard this before. When Jesus told his disciples that, I will give you power to tread over serpents and over all the power of the devil, and nothing by no means shall harm you or hurt you. And he was talking about some people that he pastored that, you know, were always getting hurt in the church or always getting hurt in their family or hurt in life. And I, well, that hurt me. And he says, well, what you need is the power of God, because when we are full of the power, nothing shall hurt you. And there's a lot of hurt people. Their feelings have gotten hurt in their family, and they can't get along. Their feelings have gotten hurt in the church, and they're wanting to leave. Their feelings have gotten hurt at work, but they ain't going to leave work because they need that paycheck. But they hold a grudge against somebody in work. George Moxley told me this week when Jesus spoke power over his disciples, over his apostles, he said, I'm going to give you power, and nothing by any means is going to hurt you. Look, we can get refilled with a power that wards off hurt, or we can go around hurt and wounded all the time. And let me tell you, if you're in the ministry, you better stay full. You better stay full. There was a man this week, and I hadn't heard this word that I'd received from Dr. Woods, that he preached a revival here. It was by a regional anointing since then. It's been years. We was in this building. He was preaching revival. He spoke original anointing on my life. I don't even really know what that means, other than when I read this, I thought, oh, my Lord, what's fixing to happen? What am I going to have to go through? See, when I see people with that great anointing, and I don't think about, boy, I sure would like that anointing. I think, my Lord, what did they have to go through? What did the devil bring against them to have that kind of anointing? Woo! I heard Juanita Bynum, and I know some people might not like her, but that was back when she first started preaching, and they were people say, I want your anointing. I want your anointing. Juanita said, you don't want this anointing, baby. Said, because you'll have to go through what I went through to have this kind of anointing on your life. I've been through hell and high water. David received that third anointing, and now he was going to have to fight all the Philistines. Have you ever woke up one day and you look back on your week and you think, my Lord, everything has gone wrong. Everything has happened. Everything has turned on me. Well, that was David's life. When he got to that third anointing, he thought, man, this is it. I have arrived. And he wakes up, and the devil's done heard what God spoke over his life. That's why it says they heard of this anointing that he had received, and they said, we're going to go challenge it. We're going to see if you are really anointed. We're going to see what God has spoken over your life. We're going to bring everything we got against you. And so the Bible tells us that that's exactly what happened. And David heard that they had gathered everything they had to come against him. And the Bible said he went out against them. That's what the anointing's for. It's when something rises up, you just rise up to the occasion. It's not you, but it's the anointing in you. It's the power of God in you. Oh, Lord, keep me full of that power, because I'm going to have to face some things. I didn't know I was going to be looking at cancer. I'm talking to some people that's gone through much worse than I'll ever see in my life. I didn't know that. I thought about that way back there when Dr. Woods said that regional anointing. I said, I must be getting close to what he said, because now I'm going into areas that I've never been before. And then this man, Thursday night, I think his name was Brother McDonald from Arkansas. He was praying. I was so tired. We had ministered. We had practiced. We had worked. And we had done everything we could for our part. We were assigned the praise and worship and the music and the program. And we had worked together as a team to make that happen. And I was wore out. And he was preaching. And he was laying hands on people. And I want to just, have you ever, when they said raise your hands and praise the Lord, you said, well, I'm going to do it. I'm not feeling like doing it, but I'm going to do it. How many times have I told you to do it and you said, okay, but I sure don't feel like praising him. That's when you better look out, because God's fixing to send you a blessing. I was in the back. They had a reserved place for us if you look on the stage, if you look this way in the church, I was on the back, Rachel and I, it was full, so we were kind of in our reserve place on the back of that particular section, and he started praying for people, and he brought his praise team there, and so we said, you let them do the altar service, and that was a God thing, because we got to be a part of the altar service, and he laid hands on us, and he came around, and I wasn't feeling it. I'm telling you, the message was awesome, but I just was tired. I was wore out. I was beat up, and I was standing, and I was saying, Lord God, just touch my body tonight. Touch my mind tonight. The enemy's coming against me. Touch me. And I guess he told the pastor, because he made his way over all them people and he kept on one layer after another, and he finally found me and he come back there and he prayed on me. And I thought he was going to pray, Lord, touch him, raise him up, fill him with strength and power and endurance. He didn't say none of that. He said, brother, the Lord in the past, you have been operating under a pastor, a local pastor, a local church anointing. He said, but God is placing upon you a regional anointing. And then I was already studying this, and I read this, and I said, oh, my Lord, can I give that back? But I can't give. Look, the Bible says the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. So when God calls you and gives you with something, you can't give it back, because he won't take it back. He will just hound you and annoy you. He'll be that annoyer and that aggressor in your life until you surrender to what he's calling you to do. When he called me to preach, I tried to work with youth. I tried to teach Sunday school. And I did all of that. Rachel and I did everything we possibly could. I saw some guys that are pastors today doing awesome jobs that were in my Sunday school class. And the pastor's wife that I went to church there before I took that class, she had held up a white flag and said, Randy, will you please take my class? I can't take it no more. And it was one of her children that was in there. Hey, I want to tell you, I'm glad I took that class, because I poured the Word of God into them, but that was not the anointing that God wanted me to walk in for the rest of my life. You understand? Does this make sense to anybody this morning? Do you understand what I'm saying? If whatever level you operate in, if God's called you to, go ahead and enter into another level, and you're saying, well, I want to stay at this level. I don't want to enter that other level. But you can only go so far with that. You be faithful to where you are, but God's not going to leave you alone about that other anointing. That other call. And so that's all I know, is that God's given me a regional anointing. So, Lord, help me, Jesus. Lord, you better pray for your pastor. I don't know what we're going to have to face, but I know what David had to do. When God brought him to another level, every devil in the county among the Philistines said, gather every kind of devil, every kind of arsenal that you got. Get all the reserves out there that's on leave. Call them in, because we're going to David's house. We're going against him. And listen to what the Bible says. The Bible says that David inquired of the Lord. Before that, he had saw that they had spread themselves in the valley of Rephaim. Now, let's just look at that valley. They had spread themselves about that valley. Someone told me that they've been there, and it was about 100 yards long and high places on every side. So it wasn't a very big area. And they had one word, one guy told me it means was actually a wrap around. They wrapped themselves, all of the Philistines wrapped themselves around the valley of Rephaim. Rephaim means a giant. Wow. David said, I'm done with the giants. I took care of the giant. And now he found himself in a valley called the Valley of Giants. And the enemy had wrapped his armies around that valley. That's exactly what the enemy wants to do to somebody here this morning. Somebody listening to me. Somebody that's hearing this word, or maybe later will listen to the podcast and hear this word. The devil wants to keep you in that hole he's had you in that valley he's had you in. The valley of giants. The giant valley. The giant valley. David prayed. You say, well, I thought when you get anointed, you don't really have to do a whole lot of praying no more. don't really have to do a whole lot of fact. Isn't that crazy the way some Christians think? Isn't that ridiculous? You know, don't have to pray, don't have to fast, don't have to fight, don't have to war, don't have any more giants to fight. Oh, my friend, when God gives you an anointing, when God pours His Spirit in you, it's to keep the hurt that's coming from hurting you. It's to keep the darts, the fiery darts of the wicked, it's to quench them. And He's preparing us for battle. He's preparing us for war. He's preparing us for things that want to destroy us. Jesus said, the thief, the enemy, the devil, cometh not but to steal, kill, and destroy. So no matter what, you say, well, here we are again. We're in an area we thought we were done with, and here we are again. We're back in this valley again. I thought I was done with giant fighting. I want to tell you something. Later on in life, David faced another giant, and he was old and weak, but he had an Abishai. He had somebody. He saw that his king was weak, and the Bible said he had a weak attack. He was old. He was still trying to fight on the battlefield, and here come a whirlwind out of the camp. Got in between him and that giant that was trying to kill him in old age, and the Bible said, we're going to keep you at home, David. You're too old to do this. Let the young guys do this, lest the lamp of Israel be put out. I want you to know there comes a time when we've got to start fighting our battles and quit looking for a David to do it for us. We've got to start fighting and taking down giants. See, he wasn't finished with giants, Jeff. He wasn't finished with being in the territory that he had been through before, and now he's there again, thinking that this anointing was going to put him over the top and that he was in a place now that he wasn't going to have to deal with those things. No, my friend, that the fires of hell may increase about you, but they won't consume you. The waters are just going to get deeper. The floods are just going to get higher. But praise God, you won't drown. He's going to bring you through. The enemy is just trying to devise, come Jacob, if you will, a weapon that didn't work last time. He's still working on a weapon. He says it didn't hurt them last time. They were too full of God. It meant to pierce them. It meant to discourage them. It meant to make them quit. It meant to destroy them. But it didn't destroy them. They're still here. So I'm working on another weapon. I say, thanks a lot, preacher, for preaching this such an uplifting message this morning. God is calling us to be soldiers in the army. He's calling us, no matter how horrific battles have been in the past, to be prepared for when the enemy comes back. Put on the whole armor of God. Be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. There are people that thought they were over things in their life and thought that they were beyond it. I'm going to just use this little bitty instance. Maxine Hendry, God, she's shouting around the throne with Jesus today. I'm just going to use just a little example of thought we were past it, and yet here it rises its ugly head up again. She had a problem smoking, and she smoked. And she said, God delivered me, filled me with the Holy Ghost. She served as clerk here in the church until she passed away. And she said, but Brother Rigney, sometimes, I can pass an unfinished cigarette laying in the parking lot, and it hits me, that nicotine, that craving rise up. She said, believe this or not, the urge to pick somebody else. That wouldn't be smart to do, Maxine, today in COVID days. She said, the urge to reach back down and get that. Somebody's half-smoked butt. Half-smoked cigarette. and light it up. No, and here's what she said. Here's what the voice that she heard. Nobody will ever know it. You don't even have to go buy you a pack. You don't even have to go somewhere. Nobody will ever know it. Just get it. I'm telling you, you've won many battles. You've come through a lot of things, but sometimes the devil comes back and you have to fight again. Even if it's the same one, even if it's in the same place. And I want to encourage somebody. It's because God has spoken some things over you. The word has been spoken to you. And the enemy has heard it, and he wants to try to see, to test God's word and anointing that he's spoken over your life. And what I want to tell somebody is, the Bible said David prayed, should I go up? In other words, what should I do? Should I fight this thing? And this is what the Bible said. The Lord told him, said, go up. I will deliver them into your hand. Do you know what old dying Jacob said over the tribe of Judah, over Judah and his descendants? And David was of the tribe of Judah, the tribe of praise. Do you know what he prophesied over them? Thy hand will be in the neck of thine enemy. That was God's word to the descendants of Judah. Thy hand. He was leaning up on the side of his bed, half dead, almost out of this world. And he was still speaking the anointed word of God over his descendants, over his children. And he was saying, you're going to need this somewhere down the road. Somebody is going to need this word from God spoken over their seed and saying, God has given the neck of your enemy into your hand. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but God has given the enemy's neck into your hands. He's given you power over the devil. Now, you say, I don't feel very powerful. Ask God to refill you. Ask God to prepare you. Ask God to give you a fresh and a new anointing. The Bible said he come out of that prayer time with God. He went down and he destroyed his enemy. He was up to what had come against him. I want to tell somebody today, you're up to what the devil is throwing at you. You're up to it because God has anointed you. You're anointed. You're anointed. No matter what the devil throws at you, no matter what he comes at you with, no matter if it's some reoccurring something that comes back and he is attacking you with it, maybe in your mind. The Lord spoke to me this week and he said, you've got people that's dealing with depression, and they'll come and God will move and God will just pour his anointing and power out on them. They'll go a while and that thing will come back. And some of them that hear what you say this morning are going to take this. I want you to know God has anointed you. This is what the Bible says about all of these. Let's stand all over the building this morning. This is what God says about all of us. 1 John 2, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. That word seduce means trying to get you to go astray, attacking you in a way that will cause you to go astray. That's literally what it means. But the anointing which you have received abideth in you. And you need not that any man teach you. You don't need anybody telling you that this spirit of depression is not of God. You know it's not of God. And the Lord wanted me to tell somebody that it is the Holy Ghost anointing that he has given you that's going to help you rise above it. Say, well, I thought I was past this. I thought I was done with this. Perhaps it's been a while since you have been in this way. My. But the Lord is telling somebody, even though you have overcome many times this battle, the devil still comes back. But no weapon, No, come on, church. Raise your hands up. No weapon, no weapon, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Not one single weapon. He may have come back against me with something that I hadn't had to deal with in a long time. It's come back. But no weapon formed against you shall prosper. The very reason the devil is so intensely attacking God's people is because we got an anointing upon our lives. And he is enabling us to rise, pray, seek God, and stand on his word. And the Bible says he delivered the Philistines into David's hand. This word delivered, let me just leave this with you. This word delivered, listen. This word delivered, it actually means given. Given. He gave the enemy over in to David's hand. Between 30 and 50 times, some form of that word is translated. It's translated there, I'm going to give the enemy. But it means given, or has given, or will give, or delivered, brought to you. The Lord is going to place the victory in your hands. This is why Paul said, thanks be unto God, 1 Corinthians 15, that has given us the victory. Paul said, who has made me always triumph in Christ. Let's pray. Lord, thank you, God. Thank you for helping us. Thank you, Lord God, for giving us your word. Thank you, God, for empowering us. But Lord God, when the enemy strikes, no matter how many victories we've got under our belt, no matter how many times we thought, okay, this is it, I'm done with this battle, I have overcome, sometimes the devil comes back again and we're in another war. We're in another spiritual warfare. We're in another fight. We're in another battle. Huh. But Lord God, even when they come back, and Lord God, they come back more in number than we've ever seen, God, you're going to give our enemy into our hand. You're going to deliver the victory into our hand through faith in Jesus' name. I want you to help somebody this morning. This is what I'd like to do. I know it's getting really late, but if you are in a battle right now, whether it's a reoccurring battle or something new, and you need God to touch your life, I want you to raise your hand and just keep it raised. I need help. I need God to help me. I am in a battle. Saints, I want you to open your eyes, and I want you to find a hand to go get by. Get out of your seat. A prayer warrior? A spiritual warrior? You go stand. Get out of your seat right now. I know that COVID is still out there, but I'm asking you to get out of your seat and go find somebody with their hand up, and I want you to put your hand on their shoulder, and I want us to pray victory over their life right now. Go get by them and let's pray right now. Oh God, oh, the Bible says that God broke through that day like water. That place that looked like a place of giants became a place of breakthrough, Lord. And I'm praying breakthrough over every person that raised their hand this morning. We need a breakthrough. Lord, we need, Lord God, you to deliver the enemy over into our hands. Depression has got to go. Things that once had their hooks in us have got to be broken over our life. In Jesus' name, whatever is attacking your people, it's because, God, your anointing is upon them. And you've got a call upon their life to serve you and to live for you in the name of Jesus. Lord God, let the breakthrough come gushing forth like great waters, like you did for King David, like you did for your people in this story. God, you put this in here to let us understand that you bring us to a place. Sometimes it's a valley, but it's a time and a place of breakthrough. Lord, let us see it not as a valley, but a place of our breakthrough. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Right now. Right now. Ho! Right now. Right now. Right now. In Jesus' mighty and strong name. Oh, hallelujah. He's the God of breakthrough. He's the God of breakthrough. Would you stretch your hand this way? Hallelujah. I'm going to speak the blessings of the Lord over your life. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. And everybody shouted, amen. Somebody shout, my breakthrough's coming. My breakthrough's coming. You get up every morning. You confess God's word that he gave you a victory this morning. It may not look like it. It may not feel like it. But God's word is true. It shall never pass away. The flower fadeth, the grass withereth, and things go away, but his word stands true. My breakthrough comes from the Lord. Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Tonight at 6 o'clock, these precious young people are going to have service, and they're going to bring the word and praise. I'm so proud of them. This group actually said, Brother Regney, when can we have a youth service? And I said, you tell me. And we're praying about opening up all of our other services. This is our plans that we're targeting Vacation Bible School this year. And after that, we're going to try, summer is kind of a killer on Wednesday night, but we're going to try after Vacation Bible School to target the first Wednesday night after Bible School to start our Wednesday night program again. And y'all know how we bus kids in and how much we need help on that Wednesday night. So you be thinking about maybe what you can do to help us with our kids on Wednesday night. That'll be the Wednesday night following the last night of Bible School. All right, remember that. Oh, hallelujah. You be blessed in the Lord today. Thank you for coming. God bless you.